Good morning, family, and welcome to our special celebration Sunday. Happy 52nd anniversary, St. John Baptist Church. Wow! While this church may have started from humble beginnings, it's amazing to see how it has brought together such a large faith community over the years. On this anniversary of the church's founding, I'd like to acknowledge you on bringing God's posture of love to so many people and using the gift of compassion and care to do so much good. While this building may be only bricks and stone, the community it houses makes it shine like a house of gold. As another year passes, St. John, let's try to do our part being the glue that brings our faith community together. 52 years since this church was founded, the amount of growth that has occurred has been incredible. With each passing year, this church seems to not just grow older, but stronger in its outreach and more dedicated in its mission. Through thick and thin, SJBC family, you have been the rock that has kept this church together. On today, we thank God for your years of service and may this church's ministry continue for many, many more years to come. May this anniversary of our church be a sign of its continued good work and blessed ministry. Thank you for all you've done, SJBC, and what you will continue to do in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for this day. Wow. 52 years. Thank you, Father God, for entrusting us with this branch of Zion with your people. May we continue to walk in the ways that you want us to walk, teach in the ways you want us to teach, and love in the ways you want us to love, to reach where you want us to reach. We love you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this love. We thank you for this church called St. John Baptist Church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. St. John, thank you for allowing me to be part of this family. I love you, and I thank you for everything that you've done for me and mine. Now, Father God, I can't wait. It's time to go to work. Worship begins.
Praise the Lord this morning. Praise the Lord. Won't you stand on your feet with me? Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. Who is excited about this 52nd anniversary of St. John Baptist Church? I see two hands clapping. I see three hands clapping. This is a great, great day to rejoice. Hallelujah.
Majestic and so marvelous.
was a great time to bless the Lord.
Worshiping with us in person, please raise your hand and an usher will bring you a guest information packet. You can fill out the guest information card and leave it in the offering basket shortly in our service. If you're a guest online, please say, "I'm a guest," in the chat section so that we can welcome you. There is a QR code on screen for all in-person and virtual guests to scan to share your information with us. We look forward to connecting with you. Also, we invite everyone to share the link to our stream with others so that they can be blessed with our worship service. First, we'll begin with two important opportunities to serve others and bring awareness to serious health concerns. There are approximately 100,000 people living with sickle cell disease in the United States, and approximately 5,000 live in Maryland. One in every 13 people of African descent in the United States has the sickle cell trait. SJBC has a long-standing relationship with the American Red Cross and will be hosting our next blood drive on Friday, March 15th from 1 to 6 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Please consider giving blood to save lives and help find a cure. Visit redcrossblood.org. and search St. John Baptist Church, Columbia, to register. Chronic kidney disease affects more than 1 in 7 U.S. adults and an estimated 37 million Americans. The Links Incorporated and St. John have partnered to bring free kidney screenings for early detection on Saturday, March 30th, from 12 noon to 3 p.m. here in the Fellowship Hall. To register, please use the QR code on the screen or visit www.wecareblackcare.com. For those of you who have experienced grief and loss through the death of a loved one, such as a family member, friend, or even a pet, we have a grief share ministry that offers support as you manage the pain of your loss. Our 13-week Grief Share program is designed to provide a safe and welcoming space for individuals who are navigating grief. Starting this Tuesday, March 12th at 7 p.m., participants will discover that you are not alone. You will gain practical tools and strategies that will provide help and hope to manage the pain and grief of loss. And you will have an opportunity to talk about your experiences. As we continue our partnership with Howard Community College, we invite you to join us next Sunday for HCC Sunday, where we'll highlight the impact of the relationship with the church and the college, and we'll celebrate how God is blessing us to serve students. As we prepare for the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we invite you and your loved ones to Resurrection Weekend at St. John. On Friday, March 29th, join us for the Good Friday Experience featuring national gospel artist Ron Poindexter from Nashville, Tennessee. Then our Good Friday guest preacher will be Pastor John Terrace Tate from Los Angeles, California. Then on Saturday, March 30th, all youth ages 3 to 12 in our church and community are invited to the 2024 Easter Egg Hunt Extravaganza. We will have rides, food, and lots of fun. Sign up today at sjbc.eventbrite.com. Every SJBC member is asked to donate their plastic eggs and good candy to fill those eggs. An Amazon wish list has been created for your shopping convenience. Visit the church website and click the graphic that will take you to the wish list. You can also drop off donations at the church office Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and on Sundays at the Information Center. And those are your announcements for today. You can stay connected by following us on Facebook and Instagram and subscribing to us on YouTube. Please check the website at www.sjbc.org for a list of upcoming events and information. We hope that you will enjoy the rest of our worship experience today. God bless you and have a wonderful day.
Happy 52nd church anniversary to St. John Baptist Church. Here's a highlight of our wonderful history as a church. In 1970, five families, the McGowans, the Rosses, the Sheltons, the Wolfords, and the Youngs, held founding and organizational meetings that led to the formation of St. John. St. John has been blessed with four pastors and four interim pastors. The pastors were Reverend Walter Long for 5 years, Reverend Walter Parrish for 1 year, Reverend Herbert Eaton for 10 years, and our current pastor of 31 years, Reverend Dr. Robert Turner. On November the 1st, 1997, St. John Baptist Church ended its lease with the Wild Lake Interfaith Center and moved its administrative headquarters to 8910 Old Annapolis Road, Columbia, Maryland. Worship services were held in Atherton High School, while the interim sanctuary at 8910 Old Annapolis Road was being prepared for Sunday services. Then, on February the 15th, 1998, St. John Baptist Church held its first worship service at 8910 Old Annapolis Road, Columbia, Maryland. Due to the continued growth of our congregation, under the leadership of the new Church Construction Executive Committee, on September 21st, 2009, St. John moved from 8910 Old Annapolis Road to our current location at 9055 Tamar Drive, Columbia, Maryland. The membership of St. John has grown consistently over the years. In July of 2010, we reached the 1,100 mark for active members in our church. Then 1,300 in 2011, 1,400 in 2012. In 2015, SJBC reached a membership of over 1,700 members. And since 2020, SJBC has been blessed to serve over 2,000 members. praise God for the legacy of worship, ministry, outreach, and service at St. John Baptist Church.
Good morning, St. John. Happy anniversary to each and every one of you. I'm going to start our pastor's corner by inviting Brother Frederick McCullough to the platform. If he could please make his way to the platform, that would be greatly appreciated. Here he comes as quickly as he can. I want you to know, church, that last month we highlighted a number of our members for Black History Month, and in recognition that Black History is not just one month, but it's every day. And I want to highlight the fact that Brother Frederick McCullough, who was one of the original members of the first class of the Meyerhoff Scholars at UMBC. And I want you to know that at the time, the Scholars Program was designed to provide scholarships and promote PhDs in STEM for the top African American male students in the state of Maryland. And then the program faced fierce public scrutiny and doubt. But through the leadership of their president, Dr. Freeman Hrabowski, the program thrived to become a model for other programs across the country and the leading producers of African American students who go on to get PhDs in the country. And Dr. Hrabowski founded and is the chairman and CEO of Advancement Strategy, a fast-growing technology and strategy consulting firm here in Columbia. And church, I just want you to join me in celebrating our own brother, Fred McCullough, for this history-making accomplishment. And we want to thank our deacons, our ushers, our music ministry, and AV ministry for serving at the funeral service for Brother Charles Gale Jr. yesterday here at our church. And we just ask that you keep the Gale family in your prayers. Okay, now here are the pastor's highlights that I want to share today. And I want to highlight the celebration of our 52nd church anniversary. God has given our church a wonderful legacy of ministry and service. And while we heard about our founding families in our anniversary video this morning, I want to recognize those who remain as active members from our founding families. And so won't you join me, St. John, in thanking God for Reverend Sadie Wilford, who is the last surviving founder of our church. And then won't you help me celebrate Bill and Dion Ross, whose parents were founders. Dion is here with us today. We also want to celebrate our charter members and those family members that continue to serve in our church. Won't you give God some praise one more time for the history-making accomplishment of our church? And then at our 8 o'clock service, in fact, Joanne, could you please join me here on the platform? Joanne Sellers. Gloria Robb, could you let Joanne Sellers know who she is? Could you join me here on the platform? I know you were thinking I was talking about another Joanne Sellers, but yes, I was talking about you. I was talking about the Delta Joanne Sellers. Now you know who you are. All right, all right. I'm having Joanne join me here on the platform because she's representing her husband. He was at our 8 o'clock service, and we celebrated with him then, and in his absence, we're going to celebrate him during this service. And I want you to know that Joanne and Clint have been active leaders and dedicated members of our church over the last several decades. And so let's first give God some praise for the Sellers family. And then second, at our 8 o'clock service, we acknowledged and celebrated the fact that Deacon Clint Sellers, after 24 years as an active leader and member of our deacon ministry, he has chosen that this is the year, this is the month in which he is going to transition from active membership on our deacon ministry to retired status in our deacon ministry. He has been so faithful, he's been committed, he's been dedicated, and we just thank God for his caring, his compassion, and his competence in serving on our deacon ministry. So we gave him a plaque, and we presented that to him at 8 o'clock, and he took it home with him. So I don't have the plaque to show you today, but I do have his wife who is here in his stead. And so won't you join me in celebrating Deacon Clint? And I'm going to give her a big hug so she can go back and give him a big hug. Amen. And then at our 8 o'clock service, we had Senator Clarence Lamb and Delegate Jessica Feldmark. They joined us at our 8 o'clock service, and they presented an official citation in honor of our church anniversary. And it reads, "Be it hereby known to all that sincerest congratulations are offered to St. John Baptist Church in recognition of their 52nd anniversary and their continued commitment to the Howard County community through faith, service, and fellowship." Signed by Senator Clarence Lamb and Delegate Jessica Feldmark on behalf of the Howard County delegation. Let's give God some praise for our elected leaders and for their recognition.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. It is second Sunday, so that means we have youth church for our children. Can we give God praise for that? So teachers, assistants, volunteers, can you please make your way up to the stage with your signs so that we can call our children back? All right, and if you are in the ages of 3 to 18, can you please stand? Amen, amen. So if you are 3 to 5, 6 to 8, 9 to 12, and 13 to 18, you can make your way up to the front, and you can follow your volunteers out to your classrooms. Amen. Can we give God praise for our youth and for our volunteers? Come on, let's keep giving God praise for our youth as they're coming. And we have some coming through the door right now. So come on, let's keep giving God some praise. And let us pray really quickly. Dear God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to gather for our children to have their own worship experience here at St. John. Let what they get poured into today resonate with their hearts and their minds so they can go out into the world and make a greater impact from what they have learned here at St. John. And when it's all said and done, we will say that it was nobody but you who did it today and that created the great young people here at St. John. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You guys be excellent.
As our youth and children leave for our youth and children's church, we mentioned our charter members earlier, and I did not see one of the family members representing our charter members, and so I would ask Pam Richardson, could you please stand as she's representing her parents Bill and Clarence Frazier, and we also want to acknowledge her sister, Carla, and we thank God for her as well. Let's give God some praise one more time for our founders and for our charter members.
We are so blessed today to continue in worship as we celebrate our 52nd anniversary. And this is what I like about church anniversaries. It's a sign that if God can keep his house, he can keep my house. Would you just give God praise in advance for what he's doing, not only in his church, but through his church? I'm just a believer that if God can sustain his ministry, he can sustain my mind. I'm a believer if he can sustain this address, he can sustain my address. About 75 people can wave your hand and say, I'm expecting that same grace that's on this house to be on my house. Come on, I said, would you just be a witness this morning and say, I'm looking for the same anointing, the same spirit, the same flow, the same doors that God is opening at his house to be opened at my house. Clap your hands and give God praise all over the room, because he's worthy to be praised. It is giving time now, and we invite you to set your heart on what you'd like to give, how you feel the Spirit of the Lord is leading you to give in worship today. We are so blessed to even be reminded in Exodus chapter 25, where God sent the leader of the people of God to say, everyone who has a heart to build a sanctuary for me, I want you to give your best. God tells them to give fine linen. God tells them to bring fine wood. And today we invite you to give, not of your linen and of your wood, but of your financial resources, so that we, as they did in Exodus, can build God a house, so that we can push the ministry of our church. Today is our church anniversary. We certainly continue in our weekly tradition of honoring the Lord in our tithe and in offerings, but we ask that you continue to also help push the work of the ministry, asking that each person who's able to give an additional $52 gift today in celebration of our 52nd church anniversary. Somebody say happy anniversary. And we are so blessed that God has blessed this ministry. If you're one of the ones that God has used this church, this spiritual leadership, and this congregation to bless, would you signify that by raising your hand? Say me. I'm one of the ones that the word in this church has helped. I don't see enough hands for all the help I know we're giving out at this church. I say I'm one of the ones that God is blessing through the ministry of St. John. Somebody stood up as a witness, and I believe that one of the ways we can affirm our appreciation for God's house is to push the work. Somebody say, push the work. So as you tithe today, we do ask, double back on Push Pay. There is a fund called Church Anniversary. If you're giving through Push Pay like I am, you can double back and give that $52 on Push Pay. You can write it on your check if you're giving by check today. But however you do it, be sure that we push the work. And I'm excited that as God blesses this house, I believe he's blessing our houses as well. Let's pray and ask God's blessings over our gifts today. Holy Spirit, we thank you. Thank you for giving everything we have. We come into agreement with the word that the earth is yours and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Father, we ask that you bless these gifts, bless the special offerings, bless our anniversary gifts, that they would be used to advance the work of your kingdom through this church. Thank you for the witness and the work of St. John Baptist Church, that as we are faithful in our giving to you through your house, that you use what we give to build the kingdom of God here on earth. Bless these gifts. Let no man or woman suffer for giving in obedience and submission to your word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you join me in standing? Those ways to give are on the screen, and we invite you to certainly lean into electronic giving. It is the most popular way and the most simple way to give in our church. We're going to follow the directions of the ushers. Let's give in Jesus' name. Amen.
I want to be more like St. John, help us welcome Pastor Timothy McLaurin, Jr. Pastor McLaurin is the proud pastor of First Missionary Baptist Church of Frederick, Maryland. He has a passion for global missions and evangelism, and for helping to heal hurting people. He is also passionate about God's commission to make disciples, God's command to love the Lord with all his heart, mind, and soul, and God's charge to equip and empower the people of God to do God's work and God's will. He is married to the former Ms. Kimberly Rollins, and they have three daughters, Aaliyah Kimberly, Ariel Tamia, and Isaiah Simone McLaurin. He is a preacher, teacher, conference speaker, workshop facilitator, and revivalist who is ready, willing, and able to serve in any capacity in any place that the Lord calls. St. John, after the song of preparation from our male chorus, let's welcome our guest preacher, Pastor Tim McLaurin, Jr.
It's all good. No, it's not you. It's not how good you look. It's not how much money you got. It's not how smart you are. It's all God. Somebody ought to give God praise, because for 52 years, it's been all God. And for however long you've been living, it's been all God. You can do better than that. Come on, give God some praise like you know that it hadn't been for you. It's all God. Act like you know that if it wasn't for the Lord on your side, you wouldn't be where you are. You ought to act like you know that it is only by His grace and His mercy that I'm standing where I am. Somebody say thank you that it's all God. I wonder, is there anybody here who's like me? To know if there was one ounce of it that was contributed to me, I wouldn't be here. It'd be messed up, it'd be disfigured, it'd be all discombobulated, but I'm so glad God even protected me from me. Somebody say, thank God, it's all God. Amen. I greet you on the strong name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are so grateful to be here today. I tell you that I do not take this opportunity lightly, because I know that Pastor Turner could have invited many people around the country and certainly far better preachers than me. But I can tell you that none of them would have been happier than me to be here. And I am extremely, thank you. I count myself blessed to not only be here, but to also have shared this opportunity with my father in ministry, Dr. Haywood A. Robinson III. And so we give God praise for him as well. I am sure that you all were blessed at the earlier service. And, you know, I as much as I am appreciative of the invitation, I'm a bit upset about the invitation, because you're supposed to put the younger, weaker preacher first and let the stronger preacher clean up. And so I'm just thankful to be here. I want to thank you, Pastor Turner, again, for the invitation, but also for the strong way that he came to our church on last year and blessed the socks off our place. Amen. Thank you for the continued friendship that you've had with First Missionary over the years, and for the friendship that continues. We appreciate you and continue to celebrate you even as you're in your 31 years of pastoral ministry. Come on, let's give God praise for your pastor. Yeah, that's right. Let me tell you something. Ephesians 4 says he's one hell of a gift. Read it. That's what it says. So I'll explain that one later. But anyway. But also, I wanted to say I'm grateful to be in your presence for another friend of mine, your assistant pastor, Dr. Harvey. It's good to be with him and to see him. Absolutely. His father and I have been friends for over 20-some years. And so, now, which seems impossible because I'm barely that old. But I am a little upset with Pastor Turner, too, about this. I don't understand how he seems to look so good and keep himself looking that good. It must be because of his dynamic wife. Amen, Lady Turner. So we just thank her. We thank God for her as well. I'm joined here today by my wife, Lady Kim. Raise your hand so everybody knows. Stand up when everybody knows you are. And we have three beautiful daughters. Our oldest daughter is here with us, Aaliyah. She can stand up. She's going to get me when I get in the car for embarrassing her. And we got our good friend, Sister Yvette Yule, with us as well. And we're so grateful for their presence. Again, I want to thank all of the officers and leaders and to all the members here at St. John for the warm hospitality. My good friend I've been knowing for many years, Brother Lau, Deacon Lau, good to see him. And we are just grateful that the Lord has allowed us to be here today and to share with you. We appreciate your love, your warmth, the hospitality, and the spirit of worship that inhabits this place. Thank you for this amazing music ministry. I guess the guys have left, but thank you all for blessing us. There you go. We appreciate your ministry, and I am looking forward to experiencing it more. Amen. And so we look forward to, certainly we're looking forward to sharing and keeping the connection going between St. John's and First Missionary Baptist Church. As many of you may know, I'm new there. I'm just coming there. I've been there a little over a year, but we've been enjoying our time there, and I'm looking forward to this relationship continuing to blossom and grow. I know you're probably tired of hearing me, and so I will hasten on. I want to invite your attention to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians, as it seems to be the custom of this house, when you found 2 Corinthians chapter 1, if you would not mind standing to your feet as we prepare to read the Word of God together. Starting at verse 3, reading from the New American Standard Bible, we find penned these words. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of all mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions so that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For just as the sufferings of Christ are ours in abundance, so also our comfort is abundant through Christ. But if we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation. Or if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which is effective in the patient enduring of the same sufferings which we also suffer. And our hope for you is firmly grounded, knowing that as you are sharers of our suffering, so also you are sharers of our comfort. For we do not want you to be unaware, brethren, of our affliction which came to us in Asia, that we were burdened excessively beyond our strength, so that we despaired even of life. Indeed, we had the sentence of death within ourselves, so that we would not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead, who delivered us from so great a peril of death, and will deliver us, he on whom we have set our hope, and he will yet deliver us. You also joining and helping us through your prayers, so that thanks may be given by many persons on our behalf for the favor bestowed on us through the prayers of many. Amen. You may be seated. We thank God for the reading of his holy word. I'm a bit torn. I want to share a thought with you as you celebrate 52 years of ministry. Let me share this thought. Stay broken. Stay broken. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this time we have together in your word. We pray now, God, that your Holy Spirit would govern and guide our time. So govern and guide my thoughts that only the things you would have me to conceive would I be, only the thoughts you would have me to conceive will I be able to conceive. So guard my mouth that only those things you would have me to say will I be able to say. And cause this time together to be affirming and confirming of the things that you've been using this pastor and assistant pastor to preach and teach to this congregation. Thereby we'll know that we have been in your presence. Cause me also, God, not only to encourage this congregation on this anniversary, but also help me, oh God, to edify them with a word that they can take for themselves and apply in their own personal lives that they might be the better because of it. We thank you again, and we simply pray that you would give us the ears to hear, hearts to receive, and a mind to obey what you have to say to us today. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. In our text, Paul transparently testifies to the church of Corinth as he's writing to encourage them. He testifies in verse 8 that he went through a season in his life where he suffered a great affliction. And Paul describes this great affliction. He does not tell us specifically what the affliction was, but he describes how the affliction made him feel, which is crucial because if he told us exactly what the affliction was, then maybe we would think that what the principles we learn from this text are only applicable if we are experiencing the same thing. But what's more important is not what we experience externally, because we can all experience different things externally. What's more important is how they cause us to feel internally. And so you and I can experience different things on the outside, but they can make us feel the same on the inside. And so Paul, as he writes this, he describes this season of turmoil, this season of affliction that he goes through. And he says this, he said, it was a season that was unbearable. He said, I was burdened excessively beyond my strength. With that word, that Greek word there is a Greek word where we get our English word hyperbole from. Paul says, when you measure what I was going through against the capacity, my capacity to handle it, it far outweighed it. There was no type of struggling with this. There was no competition. It just knocked me out. It was like Mike Tyson's shortest fight. It only lasted 30 seconds. And Paul said, and I want you to understand something. At the time that Paul is writing this, Paul is no neophyte. He's no novice. Paul has been on several missionary journeys. He's experienced miracles. He's conducted miracles. Paul has been in Christ for a long time. He's risen. He's matured. He's grown up in Christ. And Paul said, even with my grown self, I came to a place where I experienced something that I could not handle. I want you to know something, St. John's, though. No matter how long you've been walking with the Lord, no matter what title you carry, that it is possible for you and I to experience something that is far greater than we can handle. And I know what you're saying. You're not really speaking back to me right now because you're saying, but no, I know what the song says. The song says, God will never put more on us than we can bear. And I know some of you Bible scholars are saying, and 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, there's no temptation that has overtaken you but such that is common to man. But God is faithful, for with the temptation he will provide a way of escape that you might bear up under the temptation. You're right, that's exactly what it says. But that passage is talking about temptation, not tribulation. And I know what the song says, and it sings well, and it sounds good, but it's bad theology. Why? Because Paul tells us right here, even with my big, bad apostle self, you can still be burdened excessively beyond your own strength. Paul says, I was burdened so bad that not only was it unbearable, but it was also undeniable, inescapable. Look at what the text says. The text says that that he even despaired of life. Here's what that means. That Greek word there means that there was no hope of escape from oppressive circumstances. Paul said, I tried everything I could. I couldn't go around it. I couldn't go over it. I couldn't go under it. I could not escape it no matter how hard I tried. Can I tell you that Paul said, listen, this is Apostle Paul now. He's given our most extensive treatment of systematic theology in the book of Romans and all of Scripture. And even Paul says, listen, he probably prayed. He probably fasted. He probably did everything he could think of. And Paul said, I couldn't get from under it. Then he says, listen, he finally concluded that he was also unfavored and unfriended by God. Listen what he says. He says, indeed, we had the sentence of death within ourselves. That word there, that Greek word there, means that it speaks to one who has been convicted of a crime and has been sentenced to death. They have gone through the appellate process to its final stage. And once they get to the Supreme Court level, the Supreme Court upheld the conviction and the sentence. Paul says this. Paul says, I done appealed my case to the highest judge of the land. And I believe the highest judge of the land said, no, you are to die for your crimes. Paul was saying, listen, I believe that because of some things I did in the past, God is sentencing me to die in these circumstances. Paul was going through something so bad that it messed up his own theology, because this same Paul writes in Romans chapter 8 that there is now no condemnation for those of us in Christ Jesus. And while Paul was at his lowest point, feeling abandoned and unfriended by God, all of a sudden he gets an epiphany that all of this happened so that he would depend on God. Now, I didn't tell you this part, that scholars believe that the incident he's talking about happened in Acts chapter 19. In Acts chapter 19, Paul was ministering in Asia and spent some extensive time in Ephesus. And Paul's ministry in Ephesus was so great and so significant that the text says that he was flowing so hard in his ministry that the text says that sick people were being healed by his handkerchief and his apron. Not only was he preaching and increasing the number of disciples, but Paul was flowing so hard in the Spirit and in so much power that people were getting healed just by his handkerchief. People were getting healed just by touching his apron. But watch this. What that says to me then, if in that point, somewhere along the line, Paul started out depending on God, but somewhere along the line, he stopped depending on God. And maybe it's because Paul started believing his own press. Maybe it's because he saw how God was moving and he began to be like Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel chapter 4, where he surveyed the land and looked at all that he had accomplished and allowed his pride to puff him up. And so maybe he started depending on himself. Maybe it was that Paul was no longer depending on the power of the Holy Spirit, but he was depending on his eloquence of speech, his extreme intellect, his gifting with words, and how he was able to move. Paul had been going and exercising his spiritual gift for so long that he had grown in his competence to the point where he would step aside, he would step into ministry and say, step back for a minute, God, I got this one. Maybe he had gotten to that point. Maybe after the ministry went from 5 families to over 2,000 members, maybe they stopped depending on God. After you move from a location where you were renting space to now you live in this palatial palace, maybe that's when you stop depending on God. after you transition from pastor to pastor till you get one pastor who's anointed and gifted and he stays here for 30 years, maybe you stop. After you brought in new members, 14 new members on the first Sunday, or after your youth ministry grows explosively over the last several months, maybe you stop. After the budget grows from a little to a whole lot, maybe. And I just stopped by here to tell you on this 52nd church anniversary that don't change what got you here. You started out depending on God. Keep on depending on God. Let me help you real quick and let me take my seat because my time is about up. But let me tell you something. God had Paul to go through this so that he would depend on him, because God wanted Paul broken just like God wants you and I broken. The only reason you're standing here today is because you have a tradition and a history of having leadership that's broken before God. What do I mean by broken? I'm glad you asked. What I mean by broken is completely dependent on God. God wants us broken of our independence and self-reliance. He wants us broken of our will and completely and utterly surrendered to his will. That's what I mean by broken. That's how you've gotten here. And that's what God wants you to do. And can I tell you something? The reason why God wants you and I broken individually and he wants this church broken corporately is not because he's ego tripping. No, that's not the reason why. The reason why is because God understands that on the other side of brokenness, there are some blessings that you and I can experience on this side. And let me give you some quick blessings that brokenness is on the other side of brokenness that the text mentions. Number one, in verse 3, notice he says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercy and the God of all comforts." That is a unique salutation that is unique to this particular book. There are other similar ones. The closest one is in the book of Ephesians, but this is particularly unique. It almost sounds redundant. And so I had to ask God, and as I studied this and I looked at it, what I discovered was, Dr. Harvey, what I discovered was is that the reason why Paul uses all these different descriptives of God was because he was identifying the personality traits of God that he's experienced in the middle of his pain. See, I know my ABCs and 1, 2, 3s. I know 3 starts before 8. But see, I started with 8 because experientially in Paul's life, he experienced 8 through 11 before he experienced 3 through 7. And so after he became broken, all of a sudden, God didn't transform his circumstances, but he did transform how he experienced them. And after he became broken, here's what happened. He had a personal encounter with God's personality. That's what happens when you and I are broken in our situations and circumstances. It positions us to have a personal encounter with God's personality. Here's what I'm trying to tell you. In the Old Testament, when they were writing the Old Testament, we find many names of God. Understand something, that they didn't always have a script to go back and read to find out these names. No, they came up with these names as they experienced God in their lives. As they experienced him being a way maker and a provider, that's when they said God the provider. As they experienced his peace, that's why they called him Jehovah Shalom. And here's the thing, as they walked with God, they came to know God through experience. In the Greek language, there are two words translated knowledge. One is oida and the other one is gnosko. Oida speaks to an intellectual or conceptual knowledge. Gnosko speaks to an experiential knowledge. Here it is. When you and I, we hear about Jesus, we hear about God, we read the scripture, we develop an oida knowledge. God wants to take us from an oida knowledge to a gnosko knowledge. Why? Because there's more power in a gnosko knowledge. In our courts of the land, hearsay is inadmissible. When all you have is oida knowledge, then all you have is hearsay. God wants you not to stand and testify for him with order or just rumors or just secondhand information. God wants you to be able to testify like an eyewitness. I know God can deliver. How? Because he delivered me. I know God can heal. How? Because he healed me. I know God can make a way. How? Because he made a way for me. Do I have any witnesses in the building? Here it is. Here, let me. I was in Bible college, and Dr. Turner, we were studying Old Testament survey, and we were at the book of Exodus when Moses asked God, "Who shall I say sent me?" And God said, "I am that I am." Well, my professor at the time, who was a master in Hebrew language, taught us that in Hebrew it literally translates as "dot." I am dot, 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 meaning that God was telling him to tell them, I am whoever you need me to be. Listen, when he taught us that, the class erupted in praise. The praise was so strong that the class ended early, but we got out late. And when we were leaving, I was still ruminating over that thing. It was still burning inside of me. I was riding up 295 on my way back home, and I just had to share. I felt like Jeremiah. It was like a fire shut up in my bones, and so I had to share it with somebody. I called up my grandma. My grandmother was the spiritual backbone of my family. She was the first one to speak over me and to introduce me to Jesus Christ, and so I called up my grandmother, told her what I learned in class, and my grandmother said, "Baby, that's nice." I pulled over, looked at the phone, said, "What you mean that's nice?" Now, to be honest, if I were in her presence, I would not have said that. Because her response would have included some physicality. But since I was down the road on 295, I felt like I was safe. So she said, I said, "What do you mean?" I said, "Did you know that that's what the Hebrew said?" And she said, "No, I did not know that's what the Hebrew said." She said, "But I did know that whatever I needed, he is." And she proceeded. She proceeded to scold me. And she said, "Do you remember that time when you and I were coming home from the supermarket and two men stuck us up and put a knife to your neck?" So I prayed then and I found out that God was a protector. She said, "Do you remember that time in 1996 when you were on your way down to the Impact Conference in Atlanta? They called y'all down to the hospital. Said I wasn't going to make it through the night. You were about to cancel your trip. And I told you, go on, I'll be here when you get back." She said, "I found out then that he was a healer." She said, "Do you remember that time I got stuck in a snowstorm and a blizzard and I was stuck under a car? You were so busy crying that you couldn't go for help. I started praying and all of a sudden, your little four-year-old self, God gave you the strength to pull me out from underneath that car." She said, "I found out then God was a waymaker. I didn't have to go to Bible college and seminary, but I walked with Jesus through the hard knocks of life, and I found out that whatever I need, he is." Listen, when you and I are broken, it positions us to have a personal encounter of God's personality. Not only that, but it positions us to experience God's provisions. You got to look at the text with me. Look at verse 5 with me. He says in verse 5, he says this. He says, "For just as the sufferings of ours are abundant in Christ, so also our comfort is abundant through Christ." Here's what he's saying. He's saying this, that When we are, and then in verse 7, he says, "And our hope for you is firmly grounded, knowing that as you are sharers of our suffering, so also you are sharers of our comfort." When you and I are broken before the Lord, then what happens is we experience we get into a position where we can experience God's provisions in our life. What provisions did he give to Paul? He gave him help and he gave him hope. Remember, he had no hope of escape from his present circumstances. Paul had no hope, but now, once he became broken, he had hope. What changed? What changed not was his circumstances, but what changed was Paul's focus. He stopped focusing on his problem and started focusing on the problem solver. He stopped focusing on himself and what he could not do, started focusing on what God and what he could do. And so Paul said, when I changed my focus, it gave me new hope. Not only that, but then he gave him hope, but he also gave him help. He said, listen, as much as my suffering abounds, he said, as much as my suffering abounds, so your comfort also abounds. And so here it is. He says, no matter how long your comfort is still there. Whatever suffering I go through, your comfort is still there. And so here's what he was saying. He was saying, I found out that God's provisions, his comfort was adequate and it was abundant. Because watch this, he didn't just have enough comfort for himself. He had enough comfort to come for somebody else, even though he was still going through himself. Can I tell you something? How do you think you got here? It wasn't because life has always been easy for the pastor. It wasn't because life has always been easy for the leaders. But even when they were going through some stuff, because they leaned on God, because they depended on God, God provided what the church needed so that it could move forward. I'm trying to help somebody to understand that when you and I go through difficult times, when we go through trials and tribulations, all we've got to do is stand on the Lord, depend on him, and God will provide what we need. I know what you're saying. You're saying, then, preacher, why have I been praying for so long and God still hadn't answered yet? Let me answer that question with this story. I remember hearing a story about a guy who went hiking with his father. And while they were hiking through the jungle, the son fell into some quicksand. And if you know anything about quicksand, the more you struggle, the faster you sink. The son fell into quicksand and tried to struggle to save himself. And the more he struggled, the quicker he sank. While he was struggling to save himself, he was calling upon the father for help. And the father watched his son struggle and watched his son sink until the only thing that was left above the surface was his outstretched hand. And then it was at that point that the father reached down, grabbed the son's outstretched hand, and pulled him up. And instead of having an attitude of gratitude, the first thing the son said was, "What took you so long?" And the father responded, "I had to wait for you to stop trying to save yourself." Can I tell you the reason why some of us haven't experienced God's answer to our prayers is because we're too busy trying to help ourselves. We pray like we're depending on God, but we act like it's all us. Let me go on. To a personal encounter with God's personality and to experience God's provisions, but it's also allows us to be equipped. Watch this. When you and I depend on in allows us to be equipped, you do realize in this building is because you had a problem. The old building was too small. Problem as you depended on God and trusted God to do something he had never done before, and that is to give you a new place, a bigger place. As you did that, God equipped you for the purpose. Why? Because God knew what he was planning to add. And I hate to tell you this, but even thank God that you're over 2,000 members, but keep on counting, because the best has not yet happened. God still has more in store. But watch this, in order for you to experience the more that God has in store, you got to keep depending on him. I told you this was about Paul's issue when he was hanging out in Ephesus. But watch this, if you read the rest of Acts 19, we find out that Paul was also had an assignment to eventually go to Rome, where he was going to be sharing the gospel between the shot callers and the decision makers. Paul was going to be doing that, but before he would get to Rome, if you read Acts, he would go through a lot of trials and tribulations that were worse than the one he was in. And so God had to prepare him for that. God had to equip them for that by teaching him the lesson now that you need to depend on me. Why? Because later you're going to face some more imprisonment. You're going to face a shipwreck. You're going to face a snake bite. You're going to face all these things that you, if you're not depending on me, you're not going to make it. And so he's teaching them now for what's to come later. When you and I go through, and the text says this in verse 6 and 7, the text says this. Here's what he says. He says, but if we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation, or if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which is effective in the patient enduring of the same suffering which we also suffer. Here's what he's saying. If I'm wounded, if I'm afflicted, it's so that I can be a better minister to you. God is allowing me to be afflicted so that he can pour his comfort into me, so then I can pour his comfort into you. And so sometimes you and I are afflicted not because of us, but because of somebody God has us planned to minister to. You don't know, people don't know how much that we have to go through as pastors and leaders, and you don't understand that sometimes we have to go through some things in our lives, and sometimes you're going to have to go through some things in your life so that you can be able to identify and be able to relate and minister to somebody who's going through some things. You have a grief share ministry. Why? Because there are some people in here who experience grief, and out of their experience of grief, they got a heart and passion to help minister to others who's experiencing grief. Our pain and our problems can become the passion for our ministry. Misery can become your ministry. And watch this. Here's what this lesson, this text teaches us, and I'm just going to move on, that every piece of pain we have has purpose attached to it. God doesn't waste a single moment in our lives. So everything you and I go through is because he's preparing us for something else. Let me go on. I need to tell you this. One time before I was going into the police academy, I was down at my grandmother's house. I was working out in her basement. You know, we couldn't afford a gym. I lived out in Cherry Hill. We couldn't afford a gym. We worked out in the basement. And we were working out in the basement, and we had some free weights, and I was on the weight bench, and I had my cousin who was working out with me. And he's one of those, like, ridiculously in shape and strong people, and we were working out. He was a part of what a Baltimore City SWAT team, and so I was lifting weights, and I lifted, and I got up 225 pounds. I was happy. I felt good about myself. I only weighed 125, and I was bench pressing 225. I felt like I was the man. So as I'm sitting up off the bench, he said, "No, get back down," and he adds more weight. He takes the weight up to 255. I said, "I know you strong and all, and you good. Maybe you're not good in math. 255 is more than 225, and if I could barely get up 225, how am I going to get up 255? And he had me go on, and he helped me lift the weight off the bench, and I had to control it coming down. And then he pulled it up, and I had to control it coming down, and I did 3 sets of 10. At the end of the week, I was able to bench press 255 10 times. He says, what I had you do are called negatives. And sometimes when you're trying to get stronger, you got to do some negatives. Can I tell you something? Every now and again, when God's trying to make you and I spiritually stronger, when God's trying to stretch our faith, he will take us through some negatives so that we can get stronger, better, and wiser. Let me give you my last point. I got to go. My last point is this, that you need to stay broken, because your brokenness positions you to be endowed with God's power. I know how to count, but I didn't miss verse 4. I just saved the best for last. In verse 4, here's what he says, who comforts us in all our affliction so that we will be able to comfort others who are in any affliction. Watch this. That word be able is the Greek word dunamis. It means the ability or power to do something. God is saying when you and I depend on him, he will deposit in us his dunamis power, his power for you and I to do whatever we've been called to do. And I want to let you know that, watch this, this power, the text says this power is comprehensive. It's not lacking in any area, so that whatever I stand in need of, this power, he gives me the power to be able to do it. Not only is it comprehensive, but it's communal, because it's, again, it's not just enough power for me, but it's enough power to help others around me. But watch this. The only way that God can deposit his power is when you and I are empty of our power. And so he's got to allow us to go through some stuff that drains our power bank so that we can fill us up with him. All right. Let me let you go. I got to go. So here it is. Do I have any Ravens fans in the house? Yeah. Pastor, we got to do a little bit more evangelism. There should be more. But I'm glad to see I have so many Raven fans in the house. I'm a Raven fan too, but I'm about to tell you something that you're not going to like. The last time we won a Super Bowl, we won because we cheated. Yeah. Listen, the truth is the truth. Let me tell you. So the game was going on. We were killing the 49ers. And then the lights went out. After the lights came back on, we couldn't buy a touchdown. And the 49ers were scoring at will. And it looked like we were about to lose the game. One of the darkest moments is when the offense was on the field trying to go down. And you saw Ray Lewis over on the side. It panned onto him. And he had his head bowed. And his lips were moving. And I said, oh, my God. That's our captain. If our captain is conceding defeat, we have no hope. It's over. We done lost. And then the 49ers took the field to start their winning drive. And they got down to within the red zone, to a few yards of the end zone. And this became known as Ray's last stand. And they got within 5 yards. And it looked like they were getting ready to score. But the Ravens held their own. And they stopped them in the red zone. And I was celebrating. And I was just rejoicing like everybody else was. And then I saw it. When they won the game, Ray took off his jersey and his pads. And he had underneath of it Psalm 91. And then he went to Harbaugh, and when they hugged in the middle of the field, he said, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. And I found out what happened. When Ray was on the flat line and his lips was moving, he wasn't crying in defeat, but he was praying. And see, you got to understand that the NFL has a rule that you can't have more than 11 men on the field at one time. But when he started praying, he invited the 12th man on the field. And when he invited the 12th man on the field, it gave them an unfair advantage. When he invited the 12th man on the field, it secured their victory. When he invited the 12th man on the field, there was no possibility of losing. I gotta let you know that the reason why you ought to stay broken is because as long as you stay broken, whenever you do ministry, you invite the 12th man with you. Whenever you engage in the game of life, you invite the 12th man with you. You invite the 12th man on your marriage. You invite the 12th man on your job. You invite the 12th man with your children. Whenever you pray and depend on God, the 12th man joins you. And I just gotta let somebody know, in case you need to know, the 12th man wasn't his wife or his family member. The 12th man wasn't one of his friends. The 12th man wasn't one of his homeboys. But the 12th man was somebody who down through the years have been called by many names. The 12th man has been called by the lily of the valley. He's been called the bright and the morning star. He's been called Alpha and Omega. He's been called the bread of life. He's been called the good shepherd. He's been called the door. He's been called the way, the truth, and the life. He's been called the resurrection and the life. But he's got one name that demons tremble and flee. He's got one name that's got the power to heal you. He's got one name that's got the power to help you talk right and walk right. He's got one name that when you call on that name, things begin to change. Is there anybody here who knows the name I'm talking about? If you know the name, let me hear you shout that name. That's the name I love to hear, and I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ears. It's the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love that name. Is there anybody here who loves that name? If you love the name, then say yes. Say yes. Say, oh, yes. That's the name. That's the one who died on that dark Friday, but early on Sunday morning got back up again. And when he got up, he wasn't by himself. Why? Because he had gone down to the kingdom of hell, snatched, kicked in the door at the kingdom of hell, snatched back the keys to the kingdom. And the Bible said he led captivity captive. Is there anybody here who knows? I'm so glad I was in the train. He took me out from darkness and brought me into the marvelous light. You ought to give God some praise. St. John's, stay broken. For 52 years, you've been broken. How do I know? Because I'm looking at where you are. There's the evidence of it. But don't for a minute get caught up in your own press and your own hype. You're not here because you're so good. You're here because it's all God. That's what somebody here needs to hear. You've been trying to do it all based on you. You've been frustrated, irritated, and aggravated. You can't do life just depending on you and not be successful. If you want to be successful, and if you want your best life to be the one that comes, then you got to depend on God. You got to depend on Jesus Christ to be your savior. You got to depend on his blood to wash away your sins. You got to depend on his sacrifice to be your ticket into heaven. You got to depend on him so that you can get the favor of the Father. There may be somebody in the building on this 52nd anniversary who's never put their faith in Jesus Christ. Can I act like I'm home? Okay, so I deputize our members every week. I want you to find a partner. Find a partner. Get together two or three. Go ahead. Get together two or three. Y'all gonna talk to each other. Two or three, you gonna talk to each other. I know it's a bit strange. Matter of fact, why don't everybody stand and find a partner, two or three. Find somebody you don't know if you can. Introduce yourself. Here's what I want you to do. Here's what I want you to do. Here's what I want you to do. Say to the person, say to your partner, say, do you know that God says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of his glory, even me. Do you know that in Romans 6:23, God says that the consequence of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. Do you know that in Romans 10, God says that if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, that he rose from the grave, you shall be saved. Do you believe this? Now answer each other. If you're standing next to somebody who says, listen, if you're talking to somebody who says, I'm sorry, you gotta ask one more question. Say, is this your first time making this confession? If you're standing next to somebody that says yes, I want you to raise your hand. Amen. Come on, let's give God some praise. Is there anyone else? If you're standing next and you're talking to somebody and they say, yes, this is their first time, then I want you to raise your hand. Now I want you to ask them, do you have a church home? If they say no, ask them, would you like to make St. John's your church home? If they say yes, I want you to raise your hand. Amen, amen. Now, I want you to walk that person, walk those individuals. I want you to walk that person down the aisle. Come on, come on, come on. Let's give God some praise. Look at this. Look at it. What a way to celebrate the anniversary. Good God Almighty, come on. Come on, you can do better than that. Look at it, come on. Come on, let's give God some praise. Look at what happens when you depend on God. Come on, let's give God some praise.
Come on, let's continue to bless him. Others are coming. If you're coming, come right now. Keep coming, keep coming, keep coming. The heart of God's entire church is open. Heart of God's church is open. Come on, will y'all just continue to celebrate these that have already come? Come on, let's praise God. I will be with you. Please come. I will. Saying, trust me, trust me. Come on, listen to him. I'll fight your battles. Sing it. I'll fight your battles. If you know he'll do it, help me say it. I'll fight your battles. Come on, let the whole church sing. I'll fight your battles. And say, I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. To the deacon ministry.
Good morning, St. John family and friends in the house and online. We have several new members. We have six new members coming.
Come on, let's celebrate.
Members of St. John Baptist Church. If you could just turn around when I call your name and just wave at the congregation. Angel Lewis is coming as a candidate for baptism. Lorraine Vernier is coming on Christian Experience. Keenan Ray is coming as a candidate for baptism, but he's just thinking about it right now. Bless his heart. Diana Bishop is coming as a candidate for baptism to join First John, St. John Baptist Church. Charles Farmer is coming as a candidate for baptism.
Wow.
Toni Coleman is coming on her Christian Experience. Praise God. Thank you.
Come on, I need y'all to make crazy noise for six souls. Come on, crazy noise for all six of these souls who are connected to our church. To all six of you, we say welcome home. That God has a work for you. He has a blessing for you. You're home. I'm so excited. And we look forward to how God's going to bless you after the prayer. For you, for the prayer, you can stay right here. We're getting ready to pray for all of us and you. You can stay right where you are. Immediately after the prayer, you can go to your seat, get your things, and meet our deacon ministry at this exit door. Come on, y'all, one more time. Let's celebrate our leaders and new members.
Amen. Amen. Oh, keep the praises going. Keep the praises going. Yes, we've had a wonderful word, and that word has now produced some fruit, called some more new members and some candidates of baptism. Oh, praise God on this 52nd church anniversary. Amen. As we lift up this prayer, gracious God, eternal Father, we thank you, God, for what you have done and what you are doing right now in the life of St. John. We thank you, God, because your spirit and your presence is just not stuck here in the building, but is making its way through the pews and through the lives of these individuals, Lord. You have brought through and brought forward some more people, Lord, who want to declare and now decide, Lord, that they want to seek your Holy Spirit a little bit deeper. They want to seek your presence, God, in their lives, Lord, and that they are making a commitment on this day that we all are going to stay a little bit more broken, Lord, because in our brokenness, we can lean on you. In our brokenness, we can depend on you. In our brokenness, Lord, we can give all of our all, Lord, at your feet of the throne of grace and mercy, God. We can no longer do it for ourselves, Lord, and we know that you will be with us every step of the way. Father God, we love you on this day. Father God, we trust you on this day. Father God, we give your name all the praise on this day because you have been just that good to us. We thank you, God, for all that you have done. We thank you for the mountains and for the valleys, Lord. We thank you for every blessing that has come out of our brokenness, and it yet appears what you will do for the lives of your children. Lord, we pray for these families that have represented here. We pray for all of St. John, Lord, the sick and the shut-in, those who are at the doctor's door, even on this week. We know that you will be Jehovah Rapha, and you will give a healing and a miracle. God, we just continue to glorify you. We all, by the sound of our voice, Lord, in the presence of the Holy Spirit, we will give you all the glory, the honor, and the praise that you so rightfully deserve. So let all of God's children say amen, amen, and amen again.
Amen. To all of our new member candidates, go to your seat, get your personal belongings if you have any at your seat. If you don't have any personal belongings at your seat, just go quickly to the exit door on my far right, and our deacons will be there. Deacon Walter, you're taking your time, and they're already at the door, and so let's get quickly to the door so that they'll know where they're supposed to go. And let's give God some praise for our new member candidates. And then we thank God for all who served in ministry today to make this celebration what it has been. Let's give God some praise for all of the ministries represented and for your service. And then, was anyone other than me blessed by the word of God today? Let's give God some praise for Pastor Timothy McLaurin. We thank God for you. We thank God for your gift, and we thank God for your sharing today. And we also thank God for our children and our youth ministry. And then for those that are worshiping online, if this service has touched you in any way, won't you go to the chat section and type in one word that lets us know what this service has meant to you. I don't know what this service has done for you, but my word is inspired. Go to the chat section and type in one word that lets us know what this service has meant to you. Remember, next Sunday, we celebrate HCC Sunday, Howard Community College Sunday. We're going to be celebrating with our leaders from HCC, Board of Trustees, Dr. Daria Willis, who is the president there. And so we're looking forward to a great time. Bring a friend and bring a neighbor as we celebrate the partnership and the impact that we've been able to have as a result of our working together. After our closing prayer has been given, be sure to greet someone that you don't know before you leave so that we can share in fellowship together. Now, as we get ready to close, let me leave you with these parting words. On our 52nd church anniversary, we look back to celebrate and to learn from the paths that we've taken. And we look forward to the possibilities and the opportunities that God has in store for us. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Now may the love of God, the grace of your Son Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now, this day, and forevermore. Let all the people of the Lord sing. See you next Sunday.
continue to bless him. Others are coming. If you're coming, come right now. Keep coming, keep coming, keep coming. The heart of God's entire church is open.